Yeah, let's bring a slide on the different vaccines we have here. There is the Pfizer one, which got the FDA approval now, and the Moderna one, which is similar template mRNA. Both are mRNA vaccines and two shots. And then the third one, the Johnson & Johnson, which is one shot. So those are the three vaccines used in the United States. And then world over, there is, other vaccines also of different efficacy available. But in the United States, we use these three. And they're all great vaccines in terms of, preventing the severity of the disease and making the patients, they may get, if they get exposed to someone, direct exposure, they may get the disease. But as Dr. Pradhan pointed out, they don't end up in ICU or get a, severity as common as people with unvaccinated. So any of those three are fine. There was some, question about J&J vaccine and young women and blood clots, rare blood clots, but then got sorted and they found that it's not that common. But, if you're a younger woman, then maybe, go towards the mRNA. Now the Pfizer is FDA approved, and I think Moderna is not far because they are very similar. Do you want to bring up any other pointers here on the vaccines?
No, not really. I think, if it's raining, you pick up an umbrella, you don't look at the brand. I think whichever is available, which feels tolerable to you, should be used. And they are protective. They are doing what they're supposed to do, which is really prevent hospitalizations. By that, I mean prevent severe disease and prevent death. And like I said, there is a 20-fold percent reduction in both those outcomes in vaccinated versus unvaccinated people.
So that's huge, 24% reduction, and then, if you've been seeing a lot of patients, I've been seeing a lot of patients, but I have not seen a single patient's, and again, it's a small subset of data, but at least it gives you a flavor. I've not seen a single patient with critical, side effect from the vaccine that they need to be intubated or anaphylactic reaction. Can it happen? Sure, it can happen when you give it to
Yes.
billions of people. But, we've seen a lot of patients, unfortunately, who are intubated or even go on ECMO, from the effect of the COVID-19, but hardly any patients go on the, BiPAP or ventilator on ECMO from the effect of the, considering now it's been given to billions of people. You may get a
Right.
very small idiopathic reaction from anything. Even with taking aspirin, which is over the counter, you get, millions of cases with GI bleed and, severe side effects. But that's true with anything. But, point is, as you said, 24% reduction in mortality is nothing to sneeze at.
Yeah, certainly is efficacious. And about anaphylaxis, there have been reports, and the CDC website also documents those. People did need to, go to the hospital, needed to get epinephrine. They had to be some had to be intubated, but nobody, they lost nobody, at least in those that series. So everybody made it out. Certainly, that was bad for that patient, but hopefully they are not going to die from COVID in the next. I don't actually know whether they got the second dose or not, or whether it was on the first or second dose, but they probably didn't give them second dose with this anaphylactic outcome. But most of these patients apparently had a history of allergies. Having said that, having a history of food allergies or latex allergies are not a contraindication to the vaccines. If you are expressly allergic to what is in the vaccine, an ingredient of the vaccine, then of course that is a contraindication.
I think the other point I want to bring up, Sandeep, is egg allergy is not an issue with mRNA, correct?
No, it is not. And people can with egg allergies can take it. And in fact, it used to be said about flu vaccines that, egg allergies was a contraindication. I think one of the latest recommendations is that it isn't anymore. And if you can avoid it.
Flu, it's time to get the flu vaccine too, right?
Yes, I think you can make a plug for that too.
Because you know it's going to be hard to differentiate from flu and COVID, and the testing is becoming harder to do in these days. The RT-PCR is 3-4 days out in Walgreens and other places. So if God forbid you have flu, and there's no way to tell, you're going to lose work because they're going to say get the RT-PCR.
Vaccine. You have to space in case you take one vaccine, like the COVID vaccine, and you have to get a flu vaccine, you need to put 2 weeks in between before or after.
Okay, so while we are talking about spacing, Sandeep, let's mention that, because a lot of people are getting monoclonal antibodies, so let's mention that if you got convalescent plasma, which is we're not giving as much, or monoclonal antibodies, then there should be a 90-day space.
Yes. And the rationale for that is just that, those antibodies may in some way theoretically blunt the immune response that is generated by the vaccine. This is not a done deal, but this is with an abundance of caution that recommendation has come to be. The corollary being that if you have the monoclonal antibodies, it's going to protect you for about 3 months. So you are not unprotected. And then, of course, you take the vaccine and then develop an immunity. Which you can depend on rather than take it in the beginning and then wonder whether it produced an immune response.
And while we are on the topic, let's also mention that why if you get COVID-19 and the CDC saying that minute you can come out of isolation, maybe 10 days, you should be eligible to get vaccine. And the reason behind that is, the immunity you get from COVID-19 is a holistic immunity. That means you get it against the whole capsule of the virus, not specifically against the spike proteins, which is tailor-made with vaccines. So if you have COVID-19, yes, you have some built-in immunity, but that's may not protect you from future infections as much as the vaccine, because the immunity you're getting, the antibodies you're getting, may not be neutralizing antibodies with COVID-19. Infection per se, and everyone has a different response. In other words, if you have a mild infection, you may get a mild COVID-19 antibody response. And the sad part or the unfortunate part, I think it will take time. Like for example, MMR, we can detect whether you have antibodies, before you want a booster. Let's say for a healthcare worker who does not remember if they have MMR, we can do a antibody test and know for sure. Okay, you have enough. You don't need a booster, but we don't have the neutralizing antibody quantitative test on the SARS-CoV-19 yet, though it's in academic settings, you can find it, but not on a commercial level. Until we have that, IgG, IgM antibody test we do has no value in my opinion.
Right, we really don't know how to put that into context of lasting immunity or whether it's working immunity. You're right on that front. And so that also, one point I would like to make is you don't need to check this test to determine whether you need to get in case you're going to get a booster shot or not once they come down the road, or you need to get an additional shot or not, because the levels may not be really indicative of what's actually happening in the body and whether it's protective or not. So it can give you some indication, but it's not confirmatory. A lot of this is still being worked out. At some point in the future, we will have a definitive answer. But as of now, they don't really give anything definitive. They allow you to make some estimates, but that's all.
Yeah, that's a good point. In terms of COVID-19 and long-term COVID, there is some data, early data now, that having vaccination, though you can get the COVID-19 Delta strain after two shots, but there is some early data that it may reduce your long COVID-19 side effects. So that's another reason for the vaccination. Though the data is preliminary and early, but that also something to consider.
Yeah, people are looking at it. Again, I don't think it's settled.
No.
It's kind of
early data. Yeah.
Right. Because again, you know, the whole long COVID is a big syndrome. There are multiple conditions under that bracket. And some of those conditions may not have the same mechanism that drives them, namely either autoimmunity or more immunity or prolonged inflammation or sustained virus in sanctuary sites or something like that. Meaning, I think a lot needs to be
done,
deciphered.
Right.